I love that. This reminds me of a saying by the writer Ursula K. Le Guin, where she said something like, and I might I'm paraphrasing, but she says, artists and dreamers are realists of a broader reality. So I think this proof of concept thing, it's like you just have to prove that the concept is coherent and consistent. And that's enough to give you what I would call a kind of modal range. And then you can work out the sort of practical details later on, you know.
That's a really good way to put it.
You discuss Leibniz extensively throughout the book, and you know, his ideas seem to have an ambivalent import for thinking about the internet, you know. I think you've already answered part of the question, but I'll say it anyway. What initially brought you to think about the internet through the lens of Leibniz? And might his ideas help us think through our think about our relationship with the internet?
You know, one critic said that I exaggerate Leibniz's relevance for this story. Now, I don't think it's true. I mean, a bit of autobiography here. I wrote my doctoral dissertation years ago on Leibniz, and for some years I wanted to get away from him and work on other topics. But at some point I realized you can't go wrong with Leibniz, but you also can't really divorce him, right? Because everywhere you go, like every new corner you try to turn, he's already standing there, right?
He created binary.
He's he's at the beginning of so many developments, not just in philosophy, but in science and culture and technology more broadly. So he's everywhere. And he really is one of the people to have kind of envisioned most lucidly the following centuries, right? And so he's a sort of prophet of the modern period. Though he was also, and you know, this is his own self-description, he was also an optimist, and he gives the best case scenario for how the world is going to be. And as we know, it didn't really turn out perfect as
Bless his
he.
heart.
So I still admire that optimism. I think it's I think it's a healthy a healthy antidote to defeatism, certainly. It's in particular with the range of things he thought machines could help us solve. Again, he was also a career diplomat, and he believed that someday, when two empires are about to go to war, their respective diplomats could just pull out the old reckoning engine and say, Calculemus, let us calculate. And then they could just punch in their respective positions. And then a ticker tape or something would come out and tell them which empire is right. Right. And then they could say, oh, okay, yeah, we don't have to go to war. The machine solved it for us. Now, obviously, today, we have machines that are implicated in war, but they're not solving the problem, they're exacerbating it, right? And so Leibniz's expectation that the reckoning engines would always be subordinated to our best interests really missed a couple of things. He missed the greedy or selfish or malign incentives that people would have to develop the machines in certain directions rather than in others. And he also missed, you know, this could not have been on the horizon when he was thinking about these things. He also missed the increasing distance between the human conception of the good and the AI conception of the good, the ways in which increasingly AI is making decisions we don't understand, and we're not cognitively able to hold AI accountable for, right?
Right.
It went awry.
yeah. Well, you know, I think it you can't really blame him too much. He's it's no. been about 300 years plus since he's since he lived. So I'm sure he would have had a different opinion had he been writing right now.
Yeah. And you know, I think the Enlightenment is a mixed legacy, obviously, but I'm enough of a fan of the Enlightenment to kind of admire early modern expressions of kind of the best case scenario version of what science and technology and democracy and so on are going to bring about in the world, right? We need to study those.
Although you have a lot of critical things to say about the part of the internet we call social media, you speak affectionately about Wikipedia, and I can definitely resonate with such a sentiment. I mean, growing up in the South Bronx to working class parents, I would spend hours on Wikipedia. I mean it. But are there any other places on the internet that you're particularly excited about?
Well, I mean, you know, the truth is, I use the more nefarious sites like YouTube and Twitter, and I try to use them for my good. I think YouTube explorations, trying to find music I wouldn't know about otherwise, is a genuinely beautiful thing, and I don't feel like it's transmitting to me any of its defects. I'm not getting radicalized. I'm not watching I don't even know these people's names, that Jake Paul, Logan Paul, Joe Rogan. I mean, I'm not doing that, right? I'm just not doing it. And so it's not making me dumber, right? Dumber or more radical. I think Twitter has warped my brain in certain ways, but this was something I could also say that it's been part of the ethnographic dimension of my work. I mean, as a result of writing this book, I think I became something a bit higher status in the online world than a normie, right? I'm not a normie anymore. And this was something that I did feel I had to penetrate to some extent in order to understand. And I have to say that, you know, often, however much I feel like it's warped me and others, I mean, the kids on there are funny and quick, and there is something very avant-garde about it that I have to recognize. It's where I think some of the best and quickest thought is happening in our society. And that's maybe a positive way to put it. A negative way to put it is that it is sucking up all of the best and quickest thought in our society and distorting it, right? In any case, you know, I can't deny enjoying it often. And then otherwise, I suppose I just spend, you know, I spend time on websites of libraries, particularly the Bibliothèque Nationale here in Paris. And I, you know, love being able to access manuscript scans without having to leave my home, and you know, I love the NASA website, you know. So I mean, and this comes through, I think, very clearly in chapter 5, the way that this sounds very Heideggerian, but this ready at handness of all this information, the way this has transformed our relationship to information and our ability to indulge our curiosity now is so transformed for better and for worse, I think. And the, I mean, the thing that mystifies me so much these days, and I, you know, I use this example, I always come back to this example. 15 years ago, if I were walking down the street and an idea popped into my head, like, what is a quasar anyway? I would probably just say to myself, I don't know, maybe I'll learn someday. And I'd forget about it. Now, within about 10 seconds, I'll know what a quasar is. Right. Yeah. And at the same time, I'm finding publishers, for example, mainstream trade publishers, are more opposed to obscurities than ever. Right. They don't want you to look to use five syllable words. They don't want you to use French or German words. They don't want you to touch on anything that's outside of the range of the already existing knowledge of an average reader. And I'm like, but we should be going in the opposite direction right now, because it's easier than ever to learn. And we aren't. And it's a paradox for me, and it drives me mad.
I think I mentioned that I was born and raised in the South Bronx. Mm-hmm. And I kind of joke around, but I mean this. Like, I can I can recite full passages of Finnegan's Wake, and that's because of the internet. So, like, I'm completely grateful. Like, I wouldn't be possible without it.
And maybe I mean I can't explain it, but the way you have used the internet, and I think the way I have as well, is an exception to the general rule. And I guess, you know, that general rule is becoming more hardened as feeds become more the standard interface with the internet rather than pages, right? I think, you know, American undergrads I've talked to recently seem to have no encounter with the internet other than through feeds and apps, right? And don't really have any kind of real experience of anything like a text on a web page, right?
I think the image of the feed is appropriate, because it's in the old days, and I'm not that old, you know, in the old days, you would have to look for something. Or what you would do is you'd get on a blog, and someone would review something. And then you would like take someone's human take on whatever it is, and then you go see it and try it out. Everything is sort of directly fed to you.
I try to be a bit like Nietzsche, and I try not to bemoan these transformations, to cling to the old days, because as one gets older, that just gets more and more sad, right? Yeah. But, you know, all I would insist on is that these are huge transformations, and we don't yet know what the cognitive and social and emotional outcome of these transformations is going to be. So let's not be sad, but let's be alert, right?
I think Leibniz would totally be on Twitter. How he would do it, because, you know, he did a lot of his philosophy through correspondences.
Yeah.
So I think he would totally be on Twitter.
It doesn't feel much like a republic of letters these days, but maybe people will look back on the way we communicate today fondly in the future. It's hard to imagine, but maybe.
Since this is a Japanese bookstore specializing in manga, do you have a favorite manga or anime? and if not, will you take suggestions?
I'll take suggestions. To be honest, this is something I know nothing about. It's just one of the gaps in my knowledge. I know it when I see it, but I don't know the names of anything. I did advise an MA thesis way out of my competence. It was more of a rubber stamping, but here in France, you know, manga is really big in France. It's maybe number two in the world. They just love the, I mean, manga, but, you know, graphic novels in general. So it's not so unusual to meet young French people who are really steeped in this stuff. And this student of mine did something on the kind of metaphysics of body and soul in Ghost in the Machine. And she was very insistent that she did not have any interest in the Scarlett Johansson movie version. She meant the Japanese one. Yeah, right? Yeah. That's all I remember.
Yeah, that's great.
Right, so give me a suggestion.
Yeah, I was hoping that you would let me give the suggestion. But you know, since you just finished writing a book on the internet, there is a wonderful anime that came out in 1997. Right around the, and it's about the internet, and it's and for an anime, for a quote-unquote cartoon, it is unusually well read. It's unusually, and this is around the time where there was a lot of cyber optimism. And this is like one of the few pieces of culture anywhere in the world that had a more ambivalent take on the internet.
Oh, interesting.
It's called Serial Experiments Lane.
Serial Experiments Lane?
Lane. You would love it, I think.
Okay, excellent. Yeah, excellent. I can't wait to read it.
Oh, it's actually a 13 episode anime show. So
yeah, it's something you watch. Oh,
yeah,
okay.
Something you watch. Yeah, yeah.
Okay. So
there may be a manga on it though. Uh-huh. There may be a manga, although I'm not
sure. Right. Yeah. Excellent. So, yeah.
So I think we're going on a little bit further than over 40 minutes. So I guess we can wrap this up.
Yeah.
Holding up your book, could you give us an unabashed pitch for your book?
Oh, well, let's see. I mean, I suppose I'm not good at selling my stuff. I'm terrible at doing the marketing side of it that people want me to do. I can just kind of talk about what's in it. I came into contact with the British comedian Stephen Fry, who started reading my Substack first, but then we sent him the proofs of the book, and he was thrilled with it, and he said, "Oh, how I wish everyone in Silicon Valley, everyone on Wall Street, and frankly, everyone everywhere would read this." Stephen Fry. So that's a pretty good endorsement. I'll let Stephen Fry speak for me.
Sure. I actually have like one last question, and I wanted to add it in late earlier, but I guess I'll put it in there now. There's a part in your book where you coin a term, algorithmic creep. Can you explain what you mean by the term, and where do you think it's most at work in our society?
I'm not sure. I might be taking that from someone else. And maybe I should have given them credit. Mm-hmm. I would surprise me if I'm the first person to have used it. Mm-hmm. But basically, the idea is that what I really have very little patience for is when people say, "Oh, well, I'm not on social media. Oh, or I closed my Facebook account," as if your individual habits were a solution to the much larger problem, which is that whether you're on social media or not, the algorithms that structure social media are increasingly structuring corners of social reality that you cannot escape from, right? And for some people, this includes work, right? If you drive for Uber or if you work in an Amazon factory, your work is being structured by gamified incentives that are substantially the same as those that keep us seeking likes on Twitter, even though they bring no material good, right? And if you are living in a regime with a more robust social credit system, then, you know, in a sense, your entire life is gamified. Should I jaywalk here and lose 2 social credit points, or should I go to the intersection and show up a minute late to my probation hearing and lose 3 social credit points, right? It's the game of life that is a game in the sense of, you know, being constantly constrained by strategic decision-making on the model of gaming the algorithms on Twitter, right? So it's, and then, you know, also with other aspects of the creep, or maybe better, the leap into logistics and banking and train timetables. Increasingly, these are going to be set based on algorithms, the same way that, say, Uber pricing is set now, right? And so, this seems to me to be a technology that was honed most exemplarily on social media, and that worked so potently that it's moved far beyond that, so that, again, it doesn't really matter whether you're on social media or not. And then the one other point that I insist on in the book is the looping of social of algorithms, not just the creeping, but the looping, where not only do we bend ourselves to express ourselves on social media in ways that respond to the incentives of the algorithms, but we also come to think of ourselves in ways that are substantially shaped by those incentives, right? That is, we think of ourselves in terms of the categories that are trending, right? In a very kind of algorithmically visualizable way, right? In some respects, that's just culture at work, and, you know, you see the roots of this in, you know, in the Paleolithic. In another respect, when it's all formalized and schematized and it's all happening circumstances where we're cut off from direct physical contact with other human beings, it rather intensifies the situation.
I've seen this kind of algorithmic creep going on in my neck of the world in anime fandom.
Oh yeah.
There's a book written, I think, in 2000 by a Japanese scholar of anime fandom. It's called Database Animals. I think his name is Hiroki Azuma.
And, oh, so interesting. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And he talks about, like, this is in 2000, so before the algorithmic creep sort mm-hmm. of happened, but he would describe, like, anime fans as sort of, like, similar to the way Francis Yates would describe, like, Renaissance philosophers.
Oh, wow.
with these sort of amazing feats of memory. And
yeah.
And now I've noticed and, you know, I was raised in the around that time where you could still see that kind of fandom occurring, but mm-hmm. now a lot of younger anime fans are there's a kind of flattening, and mm-hmm. that's occurred. Mm-hmm. Kind of,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
If you ask them like, well, do you know about this anime from the 1970s directed mm-hmm. by this or that, you know, mm-hmm. an older anime fan would have been like, yes, and would give you all the details. Mm-hmm. Now it's almost like the memory has been mm-hmm. sort of externalized.
Interesting. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, so we lose these old cognitive practices, including these feats of memorization, yeah. and it's replaced by a kind of streamlining that we see as a kind of contextlessness. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know, this was really fun.
Yeah.
You know, thank you very much, Justin Smith. We've truly enjoyed learning about your newest work. The internet is not what you think it is. And The Internet Is Not What You Think It is published by Princeton University Press and is available now. Look for the link in the description box below to get your own copy.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.